showed them his wealth, and perhaps he was taking pride in all that he has to show. And when this delegation left, the word of the Lord came to the king through Isaiah that everything he showed to the Babylonian delegation, all this will end up in Babylon. This was the first pronouncement in Scripture about the Babylonian captivity. And it came because of a blunder that Hezekiah did. And ever so often in Scripture, the penalty for the blunder or the curse comes not immediately, but it could well happen down to the fourth generation. And sure enough, in the fourth generation of kingship after Hezekiah, that was the last of the kings to sit on David's throne. That was the end of the kingship of David. The Babylonian captivity came. But you know, King Hezekiah still wanted to do God's will. He was a good man. One day he became very sick. And he was praying to God for healing. God told the prophet Isaiah, "Go tell the king you're going to die. This is an incurable illness. There's no way out of this. You better put your house in order. Make your last testament. This is it." And so Isaiah comes, delivers the message, walks out. King Hezekiah cries. In his bed, turns his face to the wall and prays to God to grant him life. And God hears Hezekiah's prayer. And God tells Isaiah the prophet, "Make a U-turn. Go back. Tell the king that I have added 15 more years to his life." Well, guess what happened during these 15 years added to his life? It was during these 15 years that Hezekiah entertained the Babylonian delegation. Had King Hezekiah accepted God's will for him and closed his eyes in peace, there would have been no encounter with the Babylonian delegation. But worse still, it was during these 15 years that were added to Hezekiah's life that he fathered King Manasseh. Now, if you read the chronicles of the kings of Jerusalem, King Manasseh was the worst king ever to sit on the throne of David. And not only that, this king got to reign more than half a century. The worst king on the throne of David had the longest reign on the throne. Is this how God's blessings and curses work? In fact, this King Manasseh did such utter wickedness in the sight of the Lord that no other king had ever done anything like that. You know, the chronicles of King Manasseh are the darkest pages about any king descended from King David and is part of the ancestry of Jesus. The worst character you can imagine. This king would go wage war against the enemies of Israel, and somehow with God's help will gain the victory. But guess what he would do? He would bring the idols, the false gods of these conquered enemies, and he would set them up in the temple in Jerusalem. Just think of the abomination that was done at the hands of King Hezekiah. I don't need to detail you the wickedness of this king, but the scripture is full of detailing some of the terrible things King Manasseh did. At one time, the Assyrians captured him, imprisoned him, but somehow he even got out of jail and came back. He was restored to his throne and did even more wickedness. But something is remarkable at the end of King Manasseh's life. He repented. And the Bible says, God forgave Manasseh. You know, any sinner, after reading what this King Manasseh has done, and at the end of it all, reading the words, and God forgave Manasseh, there's no sin under the sun, no sinning individual that God wouldn't forgive once we read the words, and God forgave Manasseh all the wickedness that he did. Well, be that as it may, you know, had Hezekiah accepted God's directive will for him, there would have been no King Manasseh. So, let's move on to the New Testament. There's a good example in the Apostle Paul. You know, Paul had completed his missionary journeys. He badly wanted to go to Spain, but somehow it did not materialize. The believers in Rome didn't come to support that missionary, so in effect, Paul threw the towel and was determined to go back to Jerusalem. You know, Jerusalem was believed in the time of Jesus, in the days of St. Paul, that Jerusalem symbolically represents the world. This goes back to Ezekiel 5, verse 5. This is Jerusalem. I have set it in the midst of the nations and of the countries round about. Jerusalem is a symbolic representation of the world. That's why Jesus, when he spoke about the destruction of Jerusalem, he connected it with the end of the world. You know, when Jesus gave the signs of the end times in Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21, and so on. So this was a dominant thought in the Judaism of Jesus' day, what Jerusalem stands for. So since Paul couldn't go as far as Spain, well, he thought, let me go back to Jerusalem, preach in the temple, and that will make up for the rest of the world. By the way, that's the same reason why the apostles, right after Pentecost, were in the temple area preaching there. It's like the whole world came to them. Or in effect, they were preaching to the rest of the world. So, on his way to Jerusalem, it was revealed to Paul, and it was a revelation by God, that uneasy awaits him in Jerusalem. There are those Jews who have sworn not to eat or drink until they have gotten rid of Paul. They badly wanted to kill him. And perhaps God's will for Paul was, don't rush the end of your life. God may have had further things for St. Paul to do. But Paul was determined to go to Jerusalem over against the revealed will of God. Well, when you read the last chapters of the book of Acts, you find out what happened to Paul once he showed up in the temple. The Jews thought he had brought Gentiles with him to the inner court because in the previous day they had seen him in town with Gentiles and so forth. But anyway, the commotion that surrounded Paul in the temple, the captain of the guard coming down, rescuing Paul, and the captain hearing about those Jews who had made an oath to kill Paul, hearing about it, he rushed Paul to Caesarea, and was there when Paul appealed to Caesar, and eventually he was shipped to Rome. So Paul ended up in Rome, but not the way he wanted to go. as he described it to the Romans in the epistle to the Romans. But be that as it may, here we see some interesting things in the New Testament characters. You know, think about Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. When nearing the time of going through the crucifixion, at the height of his passion in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus praying to God, if somehow there's a way to fulfill God's purposes of human redemption without him, Jesus, going through the cross, if not, but that he has to go through this cup, his prayer was that, so help me God. You know, even Jesus, in the Garden of Gethsemane, wondering if somehow there is some other way. But he yielded to God's will. You know, it's amazing that Jesus came to this world to die, to bring about our redemption that way. But I also like what Jesus said. You know, in John chapter 14, and in the next chapter in 2, Jesus talks about the coming of the Spirit, the Paraclete, the Comforter. And what the Holy Spirit would do when he comes once Jesus leaves. And I like to go through the details of what the Holy Spirit would do when he comes as Jesus promised. But I like the very first thing the Holy Spirit would do when the Spirit comes, as Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 26. And when the Comforter comes, he will remind you everything I have said. One of the primary functions, indeed the primary function of the Holy Spirit, is to remind us what Christ has said. The sayings of Jesus for us Christians are God's directive will. You know, we call ourselves Christians by virtue of the fact we take Jesus as the authority in our lives when it comes to matters of faith and faithful living. That's what makes us Christian. Christian has Jesus as his ultimate authority, the one to whom he looks unto for the final word, the final say. That's what makes Jesus Lord in our lives. It makes us Christians, because his sayings are the ultimate authority for us. And so when we ponder about what God has to say, what God says in the Old Testament, for us Christians, it is good to bring it all to the gospel, to filter it through Christ, to look at things in the light of the sayings of Jesus. Well, what would Jesus have to say about this? What would the Spirit have to say about this? You know, sometimes we like to comfort people. We want to say something nice, right? And we all go through this, especially sometimes when you go to express condolences or you visit somebody in the hospital. You know, you're a Christian, you're a believer, you want to witness, you want to say something. What do you say? You know, sometimes we say something only to regret it. We thought we're saying something nice, but it may not register well with the person hearing it. Have you ever experienced something like that? I have. And you know, sometimes even we as Christians tend to tell what I call blessed lie. You know, we go visit somebody who is terminally ill literally dying, and we somehow want to comfort the person, we tend to say, well, don't worry, all is well, or it will be well, and so forth. When we know for sure that this person is dying, it's just terminal, could be someone in the hospital, what do we say? Well, let's do the will of Jesus. Let's do the will of the Holy Spirit, the directive will. Remind the person what Christ has said. You know, just as God told Balaam, make sure you speak what I tell you. Nothing more, nothing less. And you know, friends, every time we remind people what Christ has said, we are fulfilling the role of the paraclete. We are indeed truly comforting people by reminding them what Christ has said. And so, how wonderful it would be to say, Jesus said, I'm with you. You're suffering? Well, you're not alone. The Lord is with you. See? Or, as Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Do you believe in God? You're a believer, you know. Don't behave like the unbelievers. Or the words of Jesus, my yoke is easy. To somebody who's going through tough days in life, you have plenty to bear. And so, if somebody has done something bad to you, what do you say? Why not tell them, Father, forgive them? And so, my friends, the conclusion of my message this morning is, when it comes to gray areas in life, when we wonder about God's will, it is wonderful to turn to Scripture first and foremost. You know, while I was a tourist guide in the Holy Land, which I did in my younger days for 6 years, that's how I met my wife, who is sitting here in the back with us. One of the most wonderful people I took around was Billy Graham and his family. And one day, Mrs. Graham wanted to go shopping without her husband. So she asked me to take her to a souvenir shop. And while I was with her, I asked her, Mrs. Graham, could you please tell me something about Reverend Graham's private life that makes him such a wonderful spiritual person? What does he do? And she said, I'll tell you one of his secrets. She said, every month he goes through the book of Proverbs. He reads one chapter each day. So today is October 27. He no doubt read Proverbs chapter 27. He probably knows the book of Proverbs by heart. But it is good to be reminded of God's directive will. In fact, that would serve as a wonderful guidebook to young people to get to know what's God will for them to go through the book of Proverbs. And so, friends, may God bless us as we speak what He wants us to say. Amen.